scared to talk about the Holy Spirit.
There you go.
God's Spirit is in this place. Right, no doubt about it. And so we just ask God to magnify this place and be magnified here. We lift him up. I was praying for revival. I have two reminders on my phone, one at 12:45, one at 12:35, and one at 1. And it just buzzes, and I look at my phone, it says, pray for revival. Pray for revival. And it goes off every day, pray for revival, pray for revival. And it's a reminder of how much we need to be revived as believers in Jesus Christ. And when revival breaks out, things happen. And I believe revival has happened at this place. I believe God has really done a work through Freeway. If nothing, just to shame those who think they're wise. If nothing, just to show the rich and mighty how rich and mighty God really is and how he uses the foolish things of this world. And so I'm excited about that. Okay with me? So the last point was, lust will blind you, right? We talked about that. We went through that, and it's a very passionate subject of mine. Because we have three men's houses here in Springfield and one woman's house. We have a men's center in Omaha, Nebraska. Today we have 33 men and women who we are under our care. And my number one job is to protect them here. Rick's job is to protect them in Omaha. And you know, somebody can walk out of our houses and go back into that stinking mess of a relationship they came from. And it doesn't, you know, it's okay for them, and it might not be so bad on the guys in the house, but you don't understand how bad I feel, because I can't do anything. And it makes me, reminds me of what Jesus feels, and what the Lord feels, when we go away from him, and we walk into a mess, and he allows us, because God, if we're free will, we have free will. We do what we want. We're not robots. That's my personal opinion. I believe that, and I can back it up with the Bible. But when we walk away from God and choose to live a wicked lifestyle, it breaks his heart. So it breaks my heart when I see them. I have to go watch that, see their faces on bug shots, hear about the crimes they've committed, and see the hurt they put in the church and the body of Christ. And I have to tell people, listen, you got to let them go. I have to tell people who've not been taught how not to enable people. You have to go through that over and over again. And it's heartbreaking. So. Sin will blind you. Lust will blind you. And here's the second point. Sin has a consequence. Sin has a consequence. Samson told this woman in chapter 16, verse 17 through 19, he said, I love you with my whole heart. In verse 20, the presence of the Lord left Samson, and his power was gone. You notice that she asked Samson where his power came from. Samson didn't even realize it wasn't in his hair. It was in the presence of God. His hair was a sign of his commitment to God. It was the last Nazarite vow that Samson had left. He broke his last commitment to God. And God left him. In chapter 16, verse 21 through 22, Samson's in chains now. These are all a consequence of sin. It says in verse 21 to 22, they took him and plucked his eyes out, paraded him through Gaza, and made him a grinder in the prison. Grinding for Samson was something that was very humiliating. Because grinding between millstones was a job that was done by two things. One was for women, and the other was for donkeys. They put him down there to humiliate him. Samson was blind long before they dug his eyes out. Samson was in chains long before they bound him. Samson was weak long before the Lord's presence left him. Let me ask you a question tonight. What good has sin done for you? What good thing? What fruit do you have from it? Some of you are in prison right now. You don't have no chains on, but you're in prison. Some of you are blinded by the lust, sexual lust, and you cannot see how close you are to losing everything again. Again. Because you're blinded. and you're so close to losing it again. Listen, your kids are going to suffer again. Why? Because of sin. The consequence of sin. Humiliation is going to happen to you, just like it happened to Samson. But here's the catch. Humiliation can be a good thing. Humiliation can be a good thing. James says this, God resists the proud. That word resist, it means stand against. Like some of your big brothers used to stand against the door and lock you in the closet. And there wasn't nothing to do. Some of you men had big sisters that used to lock you in the closet. And there wasn't nothing you could do. And it stood against the door. And no matter how hard you tried to bust that door open, you knew and they knew you wasn't getting out. See, God stands against the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. So how do you draw near to God? You become humble. You become humble. And that's exactly what God was doing to Samson. He was humiliating him. God stripped Samson of everything he had to get Samson to the place where Samson would call on God. See, God took stuff from Samson. God began to put Samson in positions to make him humble so he would call on God. Samson lost everything. Samson lost his strength. Samson lost his freedom. Samson lost his eyes. Samson lost his women. Samson lost his family. Samson lost his dignity. And Samson became nothing but entertainment for the enemy. Look what verse 25 says. So it happened. Anytime you see that phrase in the Bible, pay attention. So it happened. When their hearts were merry, who the enemies of God, that they said, call on Samson that he may perform for us. So they called Samson from the prison and he performed for them, and they stationed him between two pillars. Let me ask you a question tonight. What's it going to take to get your attention? What does God have to take from you? What does he have to allow you to go through in order for you to get to the place where your stinking pride's gone and you begin to listen to the voice of God? For me, it was losing everything and everyone I loved. Everybody I know or loved is in the grave or prison pretty much. From selling drugs to becoming a junkie on the street. From having courage to not being able to look people in the eyes. To thinking I was free, to a prison cell, and nowhere or nothing. Nowhere to go or nothing in my bank account. $5 a month. $5 a month. That's what I lived off of. Stick of deodorant, stick of toothpaste, 5 postage stamps. That's what you can get for $5 a month. But it was in that place. That humiliating place where God got a hold of my life. See, God took those things from me. He allowed me to get to the position to where I had nothing but God to call on. Imagine, what do you think Samson was going, what was going through Samson's mind as he was in the prison grinding wheat for the enemies of God? I bet Samson was groping in the dark. This once powerful man of God, his head shaved, his heart broken, his dignity gone, chained up, trying to figure out a way to grind the grain for the enemy. And he began to think, he thought about his family that he lost. He thought about all the had a lot of time to think. Samson was a man who was on top of the world. And now he was a slave in the prison cell. Samson was a man who walked by sight, who was led by the lust of his eyes, who is now a man who only identified with darkness. Do you know what happened to Samson in prison? This is my opinion. You look into the scripture, you tell me what you think. I believe Samson made a commitment to God in that prison cell. I believe there, in that dark place, in that prison cell. Listen, how can you lust after a woman with your eyes when your eyes are plucked out? See, God took it from him. It says in verse 22, I think it's verse 22, his hair began to grow in prison. Why does he say that? I'm a Bible nerd. I want to know. His hair began to grow in prison. We have no record of him making a commitment to God in prison. But his hair was a sign of his commitment to God. And it specifically wants you to know that his hair began to grow in prison. This is what I think happened. I think Samson was groping around in the dark one day between two millstones and it hit him. God allowed me to be captured to get my attention. God loves me enough to take everything away from me so I'm not distracted anymore. And I can truly trust in the Lord. His eyes were his number one vice, so God took his eyes. His strength was part of his pride, so God made him weak. Being able to rip the chains out, being able to break the ropes, he was unable to rip the chains out. He was unable to break the ropes. I bet you Samson was remembering all those times God tried to get his attention. I believe Samson remembered those times when he ignored God's call on his selfish pleasure. I bet Samson remembered his godly parents begging him to reconsider getting mixed up with the wrong crowd. I bet Samson broke down in that prison cell and cried out to the Lord, and his hair began to grow. I was on the run without a real friend in the whole world, scared of my own shadow, afraid to go out in the daylight. I ended up in a prison cell in 2008. I wanted to know what Jesus Christ did with bad guys. So I got a Bible. And I started looking for the bad guys. And I found a man in the tombs that was possessed by a legion of demons that the world had given up on. And everybody had counted him out. And no one could chain him or tame him. He broke the chains. Jesus Christ went through a storm into the leper's tombs and reached that man, delivered him from his demons. And he said, you're going to be an evangelist. And he called him to go to the capitalist and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I found a woman at a well that just didn't have one immoral relationship. She had six. Jesus waited in the heat of the day at the well for this woman. She was a Samaritan, unclean by the Jews. His disciples went to Samaria to get a Happy Meal. Jesus Christ stayed at the well for that woman. And the scripture says this. Listen to me. He had to go to Samaria. She said, I've got a husband that's not my own. He said, you've got six that's not your own. Go and sin no more. Guess what she did? She went to Samaria. She came back with a harvest of souls. That's our first missionary in the Bible. See, listen, forget your churchianity. I'm talking about biblical Christianity.
Come on, preacher.
See, that's what the Bible says. an unpatriotic flag burner named Matthew, who was hated by his own countrymen. Jesus called him. A man named Saul, whose main job was to torture Christians, drag them out of the house. Jesus Christ made him an apostle. See, I got excited. My sin got me in prison with nothing, no one to visit me. No one thought I would be anything but a junkie for the rest of my life. And I can promise you that's a fact. God allowed me to become a shadow of a man to humiliate me so I could become the man he wanted to be. See, sin has a consequence, but humiliation can be a very good thing, people. Amen. My last point is this. There's always hope. There's always hope. There's always hope. Samson's hair was an outward sign of his commitment to God as a Nazarite. Samson sent away his power. And when his head was shaved, it was the last straw for God. This is when everything fell apart for Samson. Samson was called to be so much more for God. He threw away all those blessings that he could have had. But there's still hope. Still hope. Listen to me tonight. I think this is a very important sermon. How many in here have read the Hebrews chapter 11? You ever read that chapter? It's called the Faith Hall of Fame. Write it down, read it. It's the Faith Hall of Fame. It's the chapter, it's like the Hall of Fame for baseball or football. But it's biblical faith hall of fame. The most famous people are there. Abraham's there. Noah's there. Isaac's there. Jacob's there. Rahab's there. Sarah's there. All those people who had great faith are there. Guess who else is there? Samson. Samson's there. See? The bravest men and women are there. The most well-known biblical figures are there. Verse 32, Samson's there. This is how it happened. The Philistines worshipped the god of the grain, Dagon. They had every ruler from every tribe of the Philistines together for worship. The enemies of God are sacrificing to their demon god, Dagon. They're praising him and singing songs to him, rejoicing over this man-made idol. Verse 23 and 24. The hearts were merry, and they called to the prison. They had a great idea. Some idiot said, "Go get Samson from the prison cell. Bring him up here so he can perform for us. Let's really celebrate." The word "perform for us" in verse 25, this is what it means. It means to laugh, mock, ridicule. But the root word means this. It gives the picture of sounds that come from mocking. Sounds that come from mocking. Look at Samson now! How strong are you now, man of God? That's the same thing the devil does when you're crawling around the floor looking for dope. Ha 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 ha! Samson's being led by a young boy. Samson says, "Lead me to the pillars." See, Samson and God had a prayer meeting in that prison. Samson then prays a great prayer of faith. He asks God to give him strength one more time. Samson, with his eyes plucked out, a slave depending on a young boy to lead him around, does more for God in the last 2 seconds of his life than he's done in his whole entire life. I'm going somewhere with this. Samson made it to the Faith Hall of Fame with the last 2 seconds of his life. Here's the kid. Here's where I'm going. What can you do with your last 2 seconds? What could God do with what the time you have left? See, God placed Samson in a position where he couldn't rely on himself anymore. God placed Samson in a position where he would not be arrogant anymore, where he could not chase women anymore, where he could not bully people anymore, where he could not taunt people anymore. God placed Samson in a position to make an impact with the rest of his life. God placed Samson in a position to make an impact with the rest of his life. You say, preacher, I'm in a humiliating position tonight. God placed Samson in a position to make an impact with the rest of his life. Samson, God has placed you where you are tonight. It doesn't matter how humiliating you are or what position you're in tonight. God has placed you right where you are. Amen. To make an impact with the rest of your life. Listen to that. You know what amazes me? After all Samson did, God was still listening for Samson. After all those years of running from his purpose, God placed Samson in a position to make an impact with the rest of the life he had left. I'm going somewhere with this. I want to get all in your business. I want you to listen to me very carefully. If you check out, that's fine. Check back in. Just 1 minute. Do you know that you are in the perfect position tonight to make an impact for the kingdom of God? You are in the perfect position tonight to make an impact for the kingdom of God. You say, preacher, I've lived my life so selfishly. I'm older in years. I've wasted my prime in addiction. Why would God use me? Because of grace. Because of sweet, amazing grace, my friend. That's why. See, God is still listening, Samson. God can use you to make an impact with the rest of the time you have left. I remember being in prison, thinking to myself, I've wasted all my life sinning. I'm 30-something years old. I'm chasing temporary pleasures. Thinking of all those people I hurt in my life, I asked the Lord to use me with the time I had left. I didn't want to. All I wanted was a purpose. It didn't matter what God did with me. It didn't matter where God sent me or what he did with my life. I never thought in a million years I would even live to be 40 years old. God has kept me alive. God has kept me alive. I never thought God would allow me to see something like this happen with my life. Today, Freeway Ministries has 4 discipleship houses in Missouri, 1 in the city of Nebraska, with a total of 33 men and women being trained to make an impact with the rest of their lives. Yeah. They're all working. Amen. They're all working and moving forward with the plans that God has for them. 4 of these Freeway Ministry meetings are going on every week in 2 different states. As I got behind the pulpit tonight, 2 other men got behind the pulpit tonight. In 3 separate counties in 2 separate states at a Freeway Ministries event. Freeway Ministries is meeting every week in 2 different states. I get to be a part of this. Think about that. I was Samson. See, God took everything from me. He allowed me to be a laughing stock. He allowed me to be broken in a prison cell, but here's the most important part of this sermon. He was still listening.
That's right.
Amen.
He was listening. He was listening. Guess what he's doing tonight, Samson? He's listening. He's listening. He's waiting for you. Stop. What are you going to do with the rest of your life, Samson? More important. I want you to think about this. And I'm done. How many more times till God says enough? I'm done. Go ahead. The Bible says this, God will not always strive with man forever, says the Lord. Yeah. The Spirit of God will not always strive with man forever, says the Lord. Here's the result of persistent sin rejecting God. It's a life of wandering. Wandering. There are people in the city of Springfield right now, guess what they're doing? Wondering. You know what they're wondering? What if? What if I would have done the right thing? What if I would have took the preacher up? What if I would have made this commitment stick? What if I would have not quit on God? I see them all the time. They've been in the seats. They've made big commitments to God. And today they're wondering in the wilderness. This is for you, Samson. Would you bow your heads, please? God is still listening. You are in the perfect position tonight to make an impact with the time you have left. It's up to you. Father, I lift these people to you. I pray, Lord, that some of them would really get it. I pray that some of them will make that decision to get out of that wicked, ungodly, immoral relationship that they're bathing in. I pray that hearts would truly turn to you, God. I pray that Samson would come out of the prison cell tonight and get between the pillars with you and say, I'm going to shake the Philistines with the rest of my life. Tonight's the night. I'm going to make a commitment to God. I'm going to turn away from this lifestyle. I'm going to truly surrender. I want what God wants with my life. I'm done. No more hurting my family. No more selling my kids out. Tonight's the night. I pray if there's somebody in this place that's lost, God, that tonight will be the night they come to know you. I pray if there's anyone in this place, God, tonight that has strayed away. They're saved, but they're broken fellowship. They've been living on their own, God. I pray tonight is a night when folks will get real serious with you. We'll give you the praise. In Jesus' name. Would you stand? These two altars over here for everybody on the bottom floor. This altar over here is for everybody else. Don't you wait 1 second, Samson. Come on.